Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to talk about rational trigonometry and what to replace angles with to make the subject a lot simpler. To understand the role of angles in modern trigonometry, it's best to go back to ancient astronomy, where the Greeks and other civilizations were fascinated by the night sky and the motion of the stars and the planets. They modeled things on a sphere. They imagined the stars to be on a celestial sphere that surrounds us. And this sphere rotated right in the evening due to the rotation of the Earth, as we now know. What was critical for them was the geometry of the sphere. Distance, positioning, and everything with respect to the uniform rotation of this sphere. So spherical trigonometry played the initial main role in the subject. For about 1500 of the last 2000 years, spherical trigonometry was the main subject, and angles naturally played a role. In the last 400 or 500 years or so, the situation has reversed, and now planar trigonometry is more important than spherical trigonometry. But the concepts from spherical trigonometry were adapted to planar trigonometry, and that's why students these days all have to learn all about angles. Angles seem to make the subject simpler, but they don't. They complicate things. Here's what we do to replace the notion of angle with something a lot simpler. We'll also go back to the ancient Greeks and think about the inclination of a line. So here we have a grid. We have one baseline L1 and another line L2, which is inclined. And it happens to be inclined 5 over and 2 up. If we go over 5 and up 2, we stay on that line. So a natural way, that goes back to the work of Thales, to describe the inclination of this line is to say, well, let's consider the ratio between that rise and that run. So 2 over 5. That's called the slope of the line. And the ancient Egyptians also had an alternative. They, in their construction of the pyramids, they used run over rise. 5 over 2. Unfortunately, both of those two concepts are problematic for geometry, because when the two lines are perpendicular, then the horizontal separation becomes 0, and then that ratio is undefined. The other ratio is undefined when the two lines are parallel. So the problem is we have a denominator that becomes 0. How do we avoid that situation? Well, let's clear our minds and think about an alternative. Here's a right triangle. There are actually three quantities to consider. That side, and the hypotenuse side. The hypotenuse side has the advantage that it is never zero. That means we should put it in the denominator. So if we consider the ratio opposite over hypotenuse, that ratio never becomes infinite. The trouble with that is that although that may be 5 and that may be 2, that distance is by Pythagoras square root of 29, and that's the kind of number that Euclid wanted to avoid. The solution is to work with quadrants, the square of the distance instead. So what we do is we define the spread between these two lines to be the ratio of the quadrants here to the quadrants here. That turns out to be the natural and good concept that makes trigonometry a lot simpler, although it does take getting some used to. So we define the spread S between L1 and L2 to be, in this case, 4 over 29. And in the general setup, when we have two lines L1 and L2, we have a little right triangle. We just drop a perpendicular from any point. We get this triangle, which has three quadrants, P, Q, and R. And then we define the spread between these two lines to be the ratio Q over R, opposite over hypotenuse quadrants. And we'll designate that spread with a little straight line, and we can put it in any one of four places because the spread is really between two lines and not between two rays. All right, now let's have a look at some examples of how these spreads arise in that bunch of natural situations. The spreads that arise in a lot of natural situations are sometimes quite simple. If two lines are parallel, like this, then the spread between them is 0. If two lines are perpendicular, then the spread between them is 1. Here are some other common spreads that occur related to the standard two triangles that we've already talked about, the 90-45-45 triangle and the 90-60-30 triangle, which I've told you occurs over and over again in this subject. With rational trigonometry, the 90-45-45 triangle has quadrants as 1, 1, and 2. Remember Pythagoras' theorem, this plus this has to equal that if there's a right triangle. The spreads here and here are equal, and they're both equal to 1 half. So that spread of a half corresponds to an angle of 45 or 135 degrees, or in radians, pi by 4. Here's the 90-60-30 triangle. Its quadrances are 1, 3, and 4. Distances, it's 1, 2, and root 3. We avoid the root 3. 1, 3, and 4 is much simpler. The spreads, S1 here, is 3 quarters. That corresponds to an angle of 60 degrees or 120 degrees. This spread over here is 1 quarter. It corresponds to an angle of 30 degrees or 150 degrees. Of course, this spread here is 1. Now, there are a lot of other spreads that occur naturally, and here's a really good example using a piece of paper that we use in Australia called the ISO paper size standard. It's an A4 piece of paper. It has the property that if we fold it exactly in half like that, the shape that we get is exactly the same as the original one. That implies that the lengths of the sides are in the ratio of 1 to root 2. So by Pythagoras, that length is root 3. And then one can work out, using trigonometry and so on with a calculator, that that angle is 35.26, and it goes on in some fashion. With rational trigonometry, the same situation is much simpler. The quadrances are 1, 2, and 3. The spread here is opposite over hypotenuse quadrants, 1 over 3. The spread down here is 2/3. In fact, in a right triangle, this spread and this spread always add up to 1. That's a good exercise for you to think about. To measure arbitrary spreads, here's a spread protractor that you can download from the internet. Okay? You can see that the spread goes from 0 here to 1, and then it's symmetric on this side and this side, so it goes from 1 to 0 symmetrically. It's not a linear scale anymore, because then it would be essentially an angle. It's not linear, but it's much simpler to work with. Once you get used to it, it's quite pleasant, and you'll see spreads cropping up in places where you never saw them before. For example, here's a tetrahedron. If we look at two adjacent faces, we can ask, what's the spread between those two adjacent faces? Well, it turns out to be 8/9. 8/9. For an icosahedron, the spread between two adjacent faces like this is, as it turns out, 4/9. For an octahedron, it turns out to be the same as for a tetrahedron, namely 8/9. And for the dodecahedron, which was the ancient Greeks' favorite mathematical object, the spread between two opposite faces turns out to be 4/5. Well, you can see my book to find out why those things are actually true. So spreads arise in a lot of natural situations. They're a great replacement for angles. It takes some getting used to, but as I'm going to show you in my next video, the laws of rational trigonometry become enormously simpler when we replace distance with quadrants and angle with spread. So I hope you're going to join me for that. I'm Norm Wildberger. Thanks for listening.